I have had some requests to kind of cut back on the rabbi jokes. Rabbis are getting a really hard time in this class, but I have to tell you one more rabbi joke. So it goes like this. Young rabbi takes over a new position, and the retiring rabbi is on his way out. He meets with the young rabbi and he says, listen, it's very nice you've got this position and you'll find it's a wonderful community and you're going to fit right in, I'm sure. But there will be times when you will experience conflict, in particular with the board of directors. It's hard to be a rabbi when you have a very opinionated board. And so I have, over my many years of experience, compiled a few really basic ideas that I think will help you if you ever experience any conflict of that nature. In my desk, you will find 3 sealed envelopes. Don't open them right away. Wait until you really have a problem, and then go back to the desk, take the first envelope, have a look at what it says there, and I have a feeling that it'll help you in whatever your problem is. I didn't tell you this joke before, did I?
No.
No. Okay, good. All right. Fred's heard it before, I think. But Fred's heard all my jokes, and he remembers them, too, which is really good. Anyways, so the joke goes like this. He's in the job for a few months and everything is going fine. And then one Shabbos, he's officiating at a bar mitzvah. And it happens to be a son of one of the board members. And he gets the kid's name wrong. Keeps calling him Mervin and his name is Morris. And over again, keeps saying Mervin. And everyone in the crowd is wincing and so on. So after the services, the father of the child, the member of the board, says, that was a atrocious. I can't believe you got my son's name wrong on his bar mitzvah. You know, we spent $600,000 on this bar mitzvah. You can't get his name right. And so tomorrow is a board meeting. I want to see you there. So, you know, he doesn't know what to do. He's sweating. He feels terrible. What am I going to do? The board mitzvah. So he decides, you know what? The envelope. So he goes back. He takes up the first envelope. He opens it up and he sees 2 words on it. It says, feign ignorance. Okay, piece of advice, feign ignorance. So the next morning when he goes to the board meeting, he says, I'm so sorry, you know, many years ago I taught a bar mitzvah boy, I looked just like him, a brilliant boy whose name was Mervin, and I kept on confusing them, and I'm really sorry, I throw myself at your mercy, it was inexcusable, and I'll apologize to the membership. And so they say, all right, fine, we'll let it go, no problem. A few months later, same kind of thing happens at a funeral where he's officiating and a man who passed away, and he keeps on going on and on about the widow, and he doesn't realize that there are 2 other widows also at the graveside from earlier marriages. He completely forgot about them. And of course, you know, they're very upset. So they say, tomorrow we're gonna have another board meeting and you'd better come prepared, right? So he goes straight back to the desk. He opens up the second envelope and it says, feign illness. So he says, aha. So the next morning he says, you know, I wasn't feeling myself. I really shouldn't have done the funeral. I had the flu, I was delirious, whatever. So they say, okay, we understand. Everyone gets sick every now and then, things like that. A few weeks later, again, you know, something else happens. He's in big trouble. They say, we're going to see you tomorrow. He says, no problem. He goes back to his office, opens up the third envelope, which reads, prepare 3 envelopes. Okay. That's a fair rabbi joke, right? Okay. All right. Tonight's topic is, this is a well-known individual. In fact, one of the great thinkers of the 20th century who laid his impact on the world, perhaps more than perhaps a handful of Jews in the modern period, and in fact a handful of human beings as a whole, because he really was a major influential thinker, Sigmund Freud, the father of psychoanalysis. I really didn't have to go very far to find material on Sigmund Freud, and I'm sure many of you have all taken Psych 101, and you all have the basic biography and, you know, the whole cigar business and things like that. So we're not going to do a review of Psych 101, except perhaps to talk about his interpretation of dreams, but I'd like to try and focus specifically on the Jewish aspects of his life and how his Judaism affected his work and perhaps how we are affected as a result of the twin foci of Freud's psychoanalytic brilliance and his Jewish background. So that's the plan for tonight. We're going to try and look at the Jewish side of Freud as much as possible in the context of course, this lecture series on famous Jewish individuals. So Freud was born in 1856 in Galicia, in a Moravia, what would be today the Czech Republic, in a small town. His family was actually quite observant. You can see him here with his father, Jacob. He was named Sigismund Shlomo Freud. The word Freud in German, it means joy. You may know many people whose name is Fried. It's the exact same word, just slight vowel shift for Yiddish. Fried is Freud, same name. He later shortened Sigismund to simply Sigmund. And of course, he dropped the Shlomo because he became a very determined atheist and at the same time a very committed Jew. Interesting kind of parallel existence, which became a paradigm for many Jews really in the 20th century, where he was very proud of his Jewish identity, resented any influence to try and have him change his Jewish identity, but at the same time he had a very negative view of religion as a whole and Judaism in particular. His father taught him Bible stories, and he went to regular Jewish education. He received the gymnasium education. It was a secular school system, but Jews were exempted from religious studies for Christians and were taking Hebrew Bible stories and Jewish history during those periods. So he had a fairly strong education in the what would later become the Czech Republic. It was the Habsburg Empire at that time. And in his youth, he moved to Vienna, which is where he crafted his reputation as a whole. We'll have a lot more to say about that. His family was observant, as I mentioned before. His mother in particular, here she is with Freud on the left at 16 years old. And he imbibed many of these stories from the Bible really as mythic stories that would later percolate into his thinking and express themselves right up to the very end of his life. His very last written works really dealt with some of the basic themes that are discussed in the Bible, his work Moses and Monotheism that we'll have occasion to speak about shortly. Now, you can't study Freud's biography without coming across, you know, what undergraduates are constantly remarking upon, that Freud's father was, if I remember correctly, some 22 years older than his mother. And Freud grew up kind of like with this fairly distant, authoritarian, you know, powerful father figure, and on the other hand, a very warm, nurturing, younger mother figure. And of course, many undergraduates will go on and on and say, well, there you go, that's the whole origin of the Oedipus complex, of the, you know, what Freud would later argue, that a child has a great attachment to his mother and resentment for his father because he feels that his father is interfering with his relationship with his mother. It certainly seemed to play out, at least in the basic parameters of the age of age disparity of Freud's father and mother. But that's something more for the psychology lectures. We're going to concentrate mainly on the Jewish lectures. He fell in love with a very observant woman named Martha Bernays. Her grandfather was the chief rabbi of Hamburg, and he wooed her with tremendous force, with tremendous energy that he had never expended before on any other person or really a project in his youth. In fact, he shifted his entire career path in order to attract her, to be able to support her. He went into medicine because he felt that would be the best vocation to attract a good Jewish girl. Although when they married, he insisted they maintain a secular household. And one of their first fights as a married couple was over whether or not she could light Shabbat candles in her own home. So Freud maintained a pretty authoritarian view over exactly how the home should observe their Jewish rituals, or not, more precisely. And at the same time, as I mentioned, he never gave up on his Jewish identity. To give you another sense of their relationship, which was a happy one and produced many children, and they found their modus vivendi right to the end of their lives. Freud was always the one who chose the names of their children, and he would always name them after his teachers. This was, you know, it's just kind of a strange thing to look at, that his children got the names of his teachers. Where is his wife in all of this? But at any rate, that's beyond the scope of our discussion today. So let's look at his medical and psychological career in particular, because that's going to affect our discussion of his Jewish identity. So Freud was, by all accounts, a brilliant student from his youth. His parents doted on him. They gave him his own special room in the house where, even though they lived in a fairly cramped circumstances, he had a place for his own study and for his own books, and he was really quite brilliant, and he was dedicated to a life of research as a whole. It took him a while to decide exactly which field he was really going to specialize in until he met his future wife, and he decided that medicine would be the way to go. He embarked on a pretty ambitious research career, associating himself with many esteemed doctors, and he did a lot of work on neurology. He studied the neurons in lamprey eels and all kinds of things like this, and actually published a fair bit as a medical researcher. But that interest in neurons and neurology slowly shifted to the evolving field of hypnosis, which he found quite fascinating, and especially the idea that physical pains could be generated by thought, meaning that people could have ideas which could then be expressed as a physical symptom, and if you address the mental notion with hypnosis, you could actually heal the physical symptom. He was fascinated with this mind-body problem that, of course, would form the roots of his psychoanalytic practice. In particular, he made the shift over to what would be psychoanalysis under the influence of Jean-Martin Charcot here. One of his children was named Martin after Jean-Martin Charcot. And Charcot was one of these early pioneers in hypnotic theory, and he especially was interested in studying hysterical women. The term hysteria at that time, it's no longer used in this context, but the term hysteria was associated with a complex of symptoms that was believed, Freud later changed this idea, it was believed to be associated exclusively with women, where they were excessively, easily agitated, they would faint, they also had a very strong libido that would be expressed inappropriately whenever gathering of men were present, the desire to be the center of attention, things like this. This whole body of ideas, which was associated since the time of Galen, way back in ancient times, with the womb. In fact, the Greek word for womb is hysteria, and therefore to be hysterical meant, oh, your womb is somehow affecting you. And here's a picture that depicts in Charcot's study where he has a whole bunch of students here, and they're observing a woman who has fallen into a faint. It's a very famous painting, and he's talking about how this is an example of hysteria actually in practice. So Freud engaged in, it brought together a lot of these elements of the mind-body problem, the idea of, addressing mental symptoms to affect what were believed to be actual physical symptoms and so on, and he was quite heavily impressed by Charcot. He joined forces with Joseph Breuer, one of a whole series of young Jews who were also engaging in this pioneering field of psychological studies, and together they wrote this manuscript, Studies on Hysteria. It was actually quite a well-received book, although one of the things that began to affect the relationship between Breuer and Freud, and also affected Freud's growing reputation as well, was his strong emphasis on the sexual roots of the problem of hysteria. He believed that it had something to do with an oversexed nature of women, and that under these kinds of conditions they could behave in this manner and so on. And this began to make Breuer rather uncomfortable. He ended up abandoning the research with Freud, and Freud went on, of course, sexuality became a central pillar in his thought. They did most of their research, believe it or not, on Jewish women. We're talking about upper middle class Viennese Jewish women. The entire field of psychoanalysis in its infancy and through much of its maturity really deals with Jewish doctors and Jewish patients. The reasons for that is something that we might want to think about. But one of those women was the famous Anna O, as she was described in Freud's writings, whose real name we know now is Bertha Pappenheim, who was actually a very important woman working, creating a network of women's shelters across Europe for runaway girls, and a tremendous amount of charitable work. But again, we have these urban Jewish women coming to these doctors seeking medical advice for a series of conditions which people like Freud are beginning to think are somehow psychological in nature. Let's go one more here. then his big leap, one of the huge moments in Freud's intellectual career that really cemented his future as one of the pioneering thinkers, was what happened shortly after the death of his father, Jacob. A death that he thought originally would not affect him whatsoever, but his mourning was deeper and more profound than he had anticipated. And he found himself really puzzled as to why he felt such a tremendous loss at the loss of his father. And so he had decided to engage on a profound self-analysis that began in the last few years of the 19th century, and he continued with one, in one way or another towards the end of his life. And Freud, in it's hard to overemphasize the importance of this self-analysis that he went through. Not only did he expose his own personality to a searing searchlight of criticism, he published it. You know, he wrote about his own self-analysis, and with very few kind of like veils of secrecy to protect himself and his embarrassment, he wrote regularly about his own dreams and what those dreams meant, no matter how embarrassing or how shameful those dreams might have been. And he was able, through the first decade in particular of self-analysis, to uncover all kinds of repressed childhood memories, at least this is the way he understood them, that he had hidden from himself for so many decades, and was now only beginning to work through a lot of the complex of things that formed his personality. What this was expressed in was his magnum opus, the book that he thought was the greatest book he ever wrote, and in fact, of the 23 volumes that have appeared, it is certainly the most influential, The Interpretation of Dreams. Freud himself, to get back to the Jewish idea for a second, he considered himself in many ways a modern Joseph. I mean, going back to the biblical Joseph, who was, of course, the great interpreter of dreams, the huge difference, of course, is that when Joseph is asked about, you know, how did he get to be such a great interpreter of dreams, Joseph says, the dreams come from God, the interpretations from God, I'm just the mouthpiece. But Freud, of course, felt that there was a scientific element to dreams, that every element in a dream was like a billiard ball knocked around the table. You could trace back the vectors of that billiard bar's passage and be able to understand exactly what it was that he was talking about. How does this work? Freud believed that you would have during the day some kind of event happen to you that would stick in your mind. You might not notice it at the time, but part of your mind, I'll show you the famous iceberg metaphor in a moment, part of your brain would constantly be chewing over what was that happened when you went to buy a coffee at Starbucks or whatever the Viennese equivalent was at the turn of the 19th century, turn of the 20th century, and you would be thinking about that and thinking about that, and when you went to bed and fell asleep, then your dream would be essentially a wish fulfillment. That you would, whatever it was that bothered you about that visit to Starbucks, it would be expressed in the dream world where every single detail of your dream was somehow a veiled reference, maybe even a joking reference, to something else that actually happened in your life, and you would review these things and you would somehow process them in the dream. Kind of like the, you know, you're filled with frustrations and desires and all kinds of you know, things that you can't carry through to their completion, and in the dream state, you can somehow catharsize. Is that a word? You can be cathartic, and you can, like, get rid of all that extra pressure. And the way that you could figure out dreams is, of course, by going to the office of Dr. Sigmund Freud, who was now treating hundreds of patients. You could lie down on his couch, which was his famous way of treating these patients, and you would engage in free association, where he would repeat some of the words that were in the dream, and you were asked to immediately repeat back the first thing that pops into your head. And then Freud, the Joseph of his time, would then put these words together and try to create a narrative out of your dream that would make sense, usually referring to some childhood memory, probably a sexual memory, and that's how Freud put this whole thing together. Notice the Latin aphorism that he put on the title, which reads in English, "If I cannot move heaven, I will raise hell," which is very appropriate, I think, for Freud's intent here, because his totally radical way of interpreting dreams was completely at variance with hundreds of years of dream interpretive technique, in which, you know, most societies believed that each individual symbol in a dream had a fixed meaning that crossed cultures and so on. He said that no, dreams are simply the scientifically determined expression of unfulfilled wishes in this dream state. It's an amazingly influential work, very controversial work as well. And in particular, I'm going to look at one last element, then we're going to go straight to the Jewish stuff. Oh, two last elements, then we'll talk about the Jewish stuff in particular. Now, one of the critics of Freud once said, and this is a kind of a nasty thing, I wouldn't normally say a nasty thing, but I think it's valuable in this context. He said that what is original in Freud is not good, and what is good in Freud is not original. Kind of a harsh statement. I hope nobody ever says anything like that about me. But in this context, the greatest discovery that he made was something that, you know, as I describe it to you, you may see the great parallel to the Jewish tradition. It's hard to imagine that he did not imbibe some basic Jewish theological concepts and then translate them into his psychological work. He argued that most of the mind, what we consider ourselves, is actually not in the conscious sphere, meaning it's happening under the water, like an iceberg, like 90% of an iceberg is under the water. We don't see that part actually moving, but in fact it is more influential than the part that we do understand. This is all Psych 101. You have the conscious mind, which is also expressed as the ego, which is a Latin word meaning simply I. The I part, the part that's talking, the part that you talk to yourself, you understand as yourself. That's kind of like above the waterline, and you see that and you recognize that as yourself, your face in the mirror. But underneath you have this unconscious, in particular the id, which is simply the Latin word for it, the it. And this is where you stuff down, through a process called repression, all of your, you know, unacceptable thoughts. You know, your desire to kill your boss, your desire to, you know, rampage and do violence and say terrible things, all that stuff that's socially totally unacceptable, and you don't even like yourself thinking about it, so you cram it down into the unconscious, and it stays there and it festers like, you know, a boil that the pus is simply developing. And how do you get rid of the pressure? Well, that's in the dream world. In the dream world, the id gets to express itself and gets to filter back up, and eventually, you know, you can work through these issues that are present in your id through analyzing dreams. Freud also believed that these kinds of ideas were at the root of all religions, that everything from the Greek classics, which he studied with tremendous diligence, are really cultural expressions of this desire to express the id really wanted to do. The greatest example, the one that is most indelibly associated with his name, is of course the Oedipus complex, in which the young man Oedipus, shown here on the left, is given a prophecy, actually his parents are given a prophecy, excuse me, that their child will one day grow up to murder his father and marry his mother. And of course that's what happens in the Greek myth. We won't go into the great details. Later, Oedipus solves a riddle from the Sphinx that's shown in this particular Greek vase, and goes on to become a great hero of the city of Thebes. But this idea of the desire to murder the father and marry the mother, Freud held that that was a cross-cultural constant, and that every child has a desire, boys in particular, have a desire to be close to their mother, who they associate as the caregiver and the source of nutrition and the source of affection. And who is this crazy guy who keeps on coming in and like getting, you know, in the way? I know myself from my own experience when my children were very, very young, including my daughter here, that they did not appreciate my presence when they were nursing and things like that. It was like, no, what are you doing here? So this idea is then expressed in Greek myth as the story of Oedipus, or in terms of dreams and things like that. Okay, there you go. That's Freud, the Freud lectures of Psych 101 in 10 minutes. I will take questions now for a few minutes. Yes, please.
It's not so much a question, but if you really think about it, what drives most people, generally speaking, it's testosterone or other
chemicals.
Yeah.
Cholent does it for me.
Cholent. Oh, okay. That will really influence the way a person responds to certain situations.
Well, okay. There's a lot. Freud has tremendous, fans even today, and tremendous critics as well, including, you know, his own disciples. Really, many of them broke with him quite forcefully. They felt that he was just obsessed with sex. Not everything is about sex. You know, like the joke is sometimes a cigar is just a cigar. That's one of the undergraduate jokes. Yes.
There was one thing where it said Anna Frank translated one of his books. Mm-hmm. That was his daughter, wasn't it?
His daughter, correct.
I know someone who studied with her.
Right. She was also a psychoanalyst. Mm-hmm. Followed in her father's footsteps. So let's go on to relationship to Jews and Judaism. So here's a picture of him studying an antiquity. He loved artifacts. He collected all kinds of, you know, what I guess you would call tchotchkes from the ancient world whenever he could, African tribal masks or Assyrian winged bulls or whatever he could get, idols, things like that. He loved it. His office was crammed with a lot of these things because he saw them as kind of physical representations of a lot of these deep-seated id-based ideas that somehow found their way into artistic expression. And this was just another example of his self-identification as a godless Jew. Maybe perhaps in the context of what you were saying earlier, that, you know, he did not believe that God existed, but he believed that humans had the power to really elevate themselves to a tremendous height by searing self-analysis. At the same time, even though he completely disassociated from the Jewish religious tradition, except in a literary sense, in which he loved to read about the biblical stories and so on, he was very proud to be a Jew. And in fact, one of the stories that he writes about in his interpretation of dreams, again, you'll recall that as a context of his self-analysis, he's constantly writing about his own dreams, his own fears. He's exposing these things to, you know, hundreds and thousands of readers over the last century. He described a conversation he had with his father when he was very young. And his father told him about what anti-Semitism was like when he was young. And once he was walking down the street, that is Jacob Freud, Freud's father, and some anti-Semitic hooligans came along and they knocked his hat off into the mud and they said to him, "Jew, get off the sidewalk." So Freud, the young Freud, Sigmund, said to his father, "So what did you do?" And Jacob Freud said, "I got off the sidewalk and I picked up my hat." And that deeply disturbed Sigmund. He wanted his father to, you know, make a stand. He wanted his father to be a hero, to be tough. He did not like the concept of his father being, you know, docile or accepting his fate. Which, you know, Jews have been historically quite, you know, it's a survival strategy. Since we're a minority, it's the kind of thing where, you know, you don't want to stand out. It's safer sometimes to simply go along with it. I know I experienced that myself as a child because I was the only Jewish child in the town where I grew up. But it reminds me, more importantly, of a joke that goes like this. Two Jews are being led out to a firing squad for execution. And one of them starts screaming, "This is a mistake! I'm innocent! You have the wrong man! You have to call this off!" And the other one says to him, "Shah! Don't make trouble!" So Freud was a very proud Jew. And in fact, one of his children describes how in the 1930s, when Nazism became prevalent and they were accosted by some brown shirts, you know, some Hitlerjugend types, young people were accosting the children, Freud came running out with his walking stick and forcibly drove away a whole crowd of young toughs. That's the kind of Jew he wanted to be. He wanted to be a muscular Jew. He wanted to be a Jew that could stand up for what was important on a physical level, even though he had no interest whatsoever in the religious component of Judaism. He was deeply, he would refuse any attempts to dissociate himself from Judaism. Like, for example, when he came into the academic world, in Vienna in the end of the 19th century and into the 20th century, being Jewish was a tremendous handicap. There's so many examples of Jews who, under pressure of economic circumstances or under with the lure of a potential advancement in society, simply converted to one or another Protestant sect and then were able to get that university post or that position as the composer or the conductor of the orchestra and so on. And this is something that was extremely common in the 19th century. And Freud refused to do it, and as a result, he didn't get tenure for 20 years. You know, one of the greatest minds of the 20th century not getting tenure for 20 years simply because he refused to give up his religion in order to receive it. This gives you a sense of his fervent attachment to Jewish identity. Yeah. So again, it's an interesting kind of paradigm in that no interest whatsoever in Judaism, and in fact, published quite a bit criticizing Jewish theology and debunking it, as he would put it, but at the same time, adamant in his Jewish identity. He really formed a kind of a cultural type. He joined, for example, the B'nai B'rith International, which at that time was a fraternal organization specifically associated with the defense of Jewish rights. You know, it's a kind of like an ADL kind of organization, still obviously very active, but he was one of the important members at the turn of the 20th century. He was also a big proponent of Jewish research into Jewish culture as a whole, and he was involved in the board of the Yiddish Wissenschaftlicher Institute, the YIVO Institute, which is currently based in New York, but this is the most famous Yiddish language scientific research institute of its day. He was also a great fan of his contemporary Theodor Herzl, and was definitely a proponent of the idea of Zionism, but he didn't believe that it could really take off. He was not convinced that the idea of settling in the Middle East was really going to work, but nevertheless, he was willing to lend a hand and support it. In particular, he was associated with the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. He was on its original founding board together with Albert Einstein, another Jew persecuted in this century for his ideas and his identity. And you know, he was a big fan of these kinds of things. So all taken together, he was definitely very, very enthusiastic as a proponent for Jewish identity, although stripped of its religious content. Let's go specifically to his last work now, which is perhaps one of the most fascinating, and at the very end of his career, he tackles Judaism head on, and he expresses his ideas in a rather unusual and strange manner. Specifically, in this last book, Moses and Monotheism, Freud argues that the biblical story as we have it is incorrect. Freud, not a biblical scholar, although a big enthusiast, and he believed that the story with Moses is not that he was sent by God to rescue a slave people. Rather, Moses was an Egyptian. He was Egyptian born, and was frustrated in his attempts to become Pharaoh himself. So rather than simply accept a second-class status, Moses chooses a slave people, becomes their leader, and then takes them out of Egypt in order to establish his own kingdom. So Moses, rather than is a Jewish hero who lives in the Egyptian world, Freud argued that Moses was actually an Egyptian who led Jews. Now, his evidence to support this thesis is very spotty, and it hasn't gone any traction whatsoever in the world of biblical studies, certainly not in the yeshiva world, but nevertheless, it's relevant specifically for what happens next, because what Freud argued was that once they were out in the desert, the Jews actually balked at Moses' imperious leadership, and they murdered him. So the whole story with being on Mount Nebo and, you know, seeing the land of Israel, the Jews couldn't stand him anymore, says Freud. And as a result, they actually took him out. Now, for Freud, this was an extremely significant thing because he felt that this was another archetype, just like the Oedipus complex refers to the desire to marry one's mother and murder one's father. This represents the desire to become the authority figure oneself. Again, reflect on Freud's own upbringing with that much older father and things like that. It's strange to kind of trace these things through. But he felt that by murdering Moses, the Jews, as it were, liberated themselves entirely entirely from the indenture. Well, that's a good word. Is that a good? Is it a real world? Indenture? Yeah, it's a good one. Okay, so from the slavery to some authority figure, and they made themselves an authority figure. And they displaced the belief in a single human leader, which is what characterizes most of human history, to a mythical god that was really the repository of all true authority. And in that creation of a god, they essentially ascribed all these moral characteristics to monotheism. And as this is the part that Freud gets very enthusiastic about, they created an entire ethical culture that followed the death of a human leader. Of course, they engineered the death of the human leader according to Moses and monotheism, but nevertheless, it represents a whole evolution of the Jewish spirit into a new realm. Now, you may not have heard any of these ideas before, and I'm not surprised, because they're really crazy ideas that that don't have much influence on the world of scholarship as a whole, but they nevertheless say a lot about what Sigmund Freud felt, that although he was a brilliant psychoanalyst, and he was definitely a very proud Jew, he was not necessarily the paradigm of Jewish identity that you'd want to name as the, you know, the honoree for the dinner that year. Okay, so let's take it to the 1930s now. Hitler, unfortunately, comes to power in January of 1933, and the atmosphere for Jews immediately declines. There was a period in the 1920s when Freud, Einstein, a lot of other Jews in Germany actually had sort of a heyday of popularity, and their ideas were celebrated quite widely. This is the period of the so-called Weimar Republic, which was bending over backwards to be liberal in order to kind of expiate the guilt that was experienced by the First World War. The victors had blamed Germany for the onset of the war, which is not an entirely fair assertion. Many of the Allies bore responsibility for the sequence of events that led to the war. And Germany, though, was saddled with a tremendously difficult, as I'm sure you're aware, economic situation where they had the war guilt clause. They had to be, you know, their military was emasculated. They weren't allowed to maintain troops on certain borders and so on. And when Hitler came to power in the 1930s, there was a huge reaction against this liberalism. There are many Germans who felt that they had been humiliated by the Allies unfairly, and it was time for Hitler to really take the country to a new position of pride and strength, which he did admirably, albeit at the expense of the Jews. And one of the things that Hitler emphasized was the idea of the degenerate ideas that had been generated by people like Freud that were overly sexualized, that were not grounded in what he felt were true German values and so on. And so there was a series of minor persecutions, which were called Einzelaktionen, book burnings, desecration of property, the occasional beating, raids by the brown shirts, kind of like hooligans wearing swastikas who would go around beating up Jews and forcing Jews to clean the streets on their hands and knees and, you know, paint signs on the walls saying Jude and things like that. And there was a whole series of increasingly difficult discriminatory measures that were put in place, especially after 1935, when Hitler enacted the Nuremberg Laws, also known as the Laws of German Blood and Honor, under which, for example, all Jews were to be specifically removed from any civil service. They were removed from any public schools, both as students and as teachers. They were not allowed to have any sort of government jobs, from postal clerks to government ministers and so on. And Jews were feeling the pressure. They really were not welcomed in Germany anymore. This culminated in the tremendous massacre of Kristallnacht in November of 1938, when there was a coordinated pogrom that took place across the entire German country, or the country of Germany, with about 260 Jews killed and a tremendous degree of property damages, synagogues burned, and so on. And so Jews who had not left by that point really knew that this was it. If they didn't leave by after 1938, after Kristallnacht, the chances are they would not get to leave at all. maybe I'm overstating the position of Jews at that time, but it was eminently clear that something terrible was brewing. Freud at that time felt that he agreed, and he felt that it was really time for Jews to abandon Germany. Specifically, he addressed the Vienna Psychological Circle, which is shown here, in which just about everybody in the circle is Jewish, and he argued that it should be disbanded and all Jews should really leave Europe. In his final address to the Viennese Psychological Circle, he compared himself to Yochanan ben Zakkai, the great rabbi who was the leader of the Jews at the time of the destruction of the First Temple, who argued that some modus vivendi must be struck with the Romans in order to perpetuate Judaism as a whole. It's very ironic that he, the godless Jew, would choose Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai as a model, but again, it gives you a sense of the complexity of Freud's relationship to Judaism and Jewish history. So the society did in fact disband, and Freud moved to England. He had a tremendous command of the English language. He had a long love for the English people and their system of government, and so he moved to England in 1938, and he died a year later after a long and heroic battle with cancer. So when we look at the legacy of Freud as a whole, we can see that it's really tremendously profound in his psychological insights, which many have disagreed with forcefully, but nevertheless the very concept that the mind is a place that is subject to physical powers, that is, that the way we think is not something ethereal and soul-like, but rather something which is mechanical and driven by various influences that occur to us in our lifetime, particularly in our childhoods. This is something that revolutionized the field and ultimately became the germ for many, many scholarly works on psychoanalysis. As a Jew, we can certainly point to his tremendous support of Jewish causes and the lending of his growing reputation to major institutions. I forgot to mention, by the way, that his sons, when they were in university, joined the Kadima Zionist group. And when he was in his 80s already, he asked to become a member himself because he really wanted to lend his support to this kind of activity. But at the same time, while he clearly identified himself as a Jew and resented any efforts to minimize that ethnic association, he had a fascination with Judaism and a tremendous desire to debunk it and to try and tear it down to its roots as he tore the psyche down to its roots. These are perhaps unfortunate expressions of his activity, but nevertheless they represent a true vision of the kind of approach he took to Judaism. That's about all I have to say about Freud tonight. I want to thank you very much for your attention. And I'll hang around for some questions.